Hi, I'm Robert Osborne, and you can see me every day hosting films on Turner Classic Movies. Well, for this special DVD edition, I'm delighted to introduce you to a favorite film of mine, Around the World in 80 Days, based on the classic novel written in 1873 by French author and futurist Jules Verne. The story of the making of this film is as wild, implausible, and entertaining as the film itself. At the heart of it is the vision of one of the most outrageous showmen of the 20th century, the film's producer, Michael Todd. This movie is responsible for giving Todd the best batting average of any man in the history of movies, because get this, he made only one movie in his life, this one, and it captured the biggest accolade a producer could ever win, the Academy Award for Best Picture of the Year. Before he made Around the World in 80 Days, Todd had a mixed bag of credits. He constructed sound stages in early Hollywood, became a producer in burlesque, a Broadway showman, and most of all, an entrepreneur. He was part of that team that developed the Cinerama widescreen movie system. It's well known that he was something of a con man, too, a fellow with charm, a gift of gab, flamboyance, and a surpassing confidence that always kept him everybody's pal and just a few steps ahead of his creditors. The film version of Around the World in 80 Days originated when Todd was at one of his career lows, and he happened to pick up a draft script of Around the World in the office of producer Sir Alexander Korda in London. Korda's advice? Back away from it, Mike, he said. I've been trying to lick it for years. Total loss. Far from discouraging Todd, though, within a few years, the property was his, and amazingly, he had it in production. By all odds, everyone expected this movie to be a disaster, not only because Todd was a movie novice, but also because he really didn't have enough money to make any movie, much less a film so ambitious. But he begged, borrowed, and cajoled, getting a few bucks here, a few bucks there for financing. Todd hired famed humorist S.J. Perlman to co-write the screenplay. Todd's biographer, Art Cohen, called Perlman strictly Mike's kind of guy, neither insecure nor neurotic. He didn't mind when Mike junked a full day's dialogue and rewrote it. It seems the combination of Perlman's intelligence and wit and Todd's instinct for showmanship was a perfect fit. John Farrow, who also worked on the screenplay, was originally set to direct the film. But after the second day of shooting, Farrow realized that only one man could be in charge of a Michael Todd production. So they parted ways, and the British director Michael Anderson took over. Now, at the time, Anderson had only directed a few films, such as The Dam Busters and 1984, but nothing that would indicate that he could handle the kind of super production that Mike Todd envisioned. But Todd decided that a young, intelligent director of good taste and absolutely no Hollywood experience was perfect for the job. There was only one actor Michael Todd envisioned as the film's lead character, Phileas Fogg, and that was David Niven, who was more than pleased to play the part. Todd felt Niven projected all the qualities epitomized in Verne's story. For the rest of his life, Niven said it was his favorite of all the roles he ever played. In Verne's novel, Fogg's manservant Passepartout is described as a diminutive Frenchman, so Todd raised a lot of eyebrows when he sought the great Mexican comedian Cantinflas for the part. Todd considered Cantinflas to be the greatest living performer. He was an actor, comedian, acrobat, musician, even a bullfighter. And it was said that he could ride anything from a camel to a comet. So despite the disparity in nationality, as far as Todd was concerned, Cantinflas was the only man for the job, if he could get him, which many doubted Todd would be able to do. Cantinflas was at the time the wealthiest actor in the world and the most independent. He owned his own production company and, despite many offers, had never made an English-language film before. But in typical Mike Todd style, he didn't let that stop him. He flew to Mexico, and within a week, Cantinflas had agreed to do the part on a handshake. Someone else of note in the cast playing the shrewd and cunning Inspector Fix is Robert Newton, giving the last performance of his long, distinguished career. The actor gained fame playing roles such as Bill Sykes in David Lean's Oliver Twist, and he also played Long John Silver in Disney's Treasure Island just a few years before. Only a month after he finished his work on this film, Newton died of a heart attack in the arms of his wife, Vera Budnick. Another of the film's stars is Shirley MacLaine, who was a new girl in Hollywood at the time. She'd been seen in only two other films at that point, one directed by Alfred Hitchcock, the other with Dean Martin and Jerry Lewis. But Shirley says she learned more from this movie than either of those two earlier ones, mainly because of actress Marlene Dietrich, who plays a cameo role in the film. Shirley says that when she did the San Francisco barroom sequence with Dietrich in this film, Marlena taught her invaluable lessons about working in front of a camera, especially about proper light positioning and finding her own key light, tools that Shirley says have helped her throughout her career ever since. Speaking of cameo roles, Mike Todd is credited with coining that term, which had never been used in connection with a movie before. Not until Todd coined it as a way of luring big stars to be in this movie without them thinking they were playing just small parts. So whenever he needed somebody for a role, Michael Todd would rush out and con or charm a famous star into doing it. Stars like Frank Sinatra, Evelyn Keyes, Noel Coward, Beatrice Lilly, Red Skelton, and Peter Lorre, all in so-called cameo roles. Art Cohn defined Todd's concept as a cameo to Mike is a gem carved in celluloid by a star. Another interesting fact about Around the World in 80 Days, it was shot in the Todd AO process, a wide-gauge panoramic presentation method that Todd pioneered after departing from the Cinerama Corporation. Todd liked Cinerama well enough, but it always bothered him that the system required three cameras to shoot the film and three projectors to screen it. So he went to Dr. Brian O'Brien at the University of Rochester and said, "Doc, I want a Cinerama camera with everything to come out of one hole. Can that be done?" Well, working with the American Optical Company, it was done, and Todd AO was born. From beginning to end, the making of this film seemed like insanity. The production was chaotic and wild, and as it turned out, absolutely inspired. Like an ending that could only happen in a movie, this frantic and peculiar production turned out so well, the movie ended up winning the Oscar for Best Picture over the films The King and I, Giant, The Ten Commandments, and Friendly Persuasion. And ever the charmer or the charmed, it was shortly after he completed this movie and while he was promoting it and winning awards for it that Michael Todd wooed and won Elizabeth Taylor as his wife. So get ready to enjoy a fantastic, one-of-a-kind journey Around the World in 80 Days, presented here for the first time on home video in its widescreen, stereophonic, original Roadshow version. An event in 1956, an event still.